a lot of territory to.
It's always, you can count on the second. Third,
last year was really pretty.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. So it's fall now, right?
Yeah.
Are you going?
Officially. Quickly, are there prayer concerns that you'd like to lift up? Claire Fortune is still at Watauga dealing with some post-surgical stuff after having her knee replaced last week. And Dick Larson has been to Duke, and I think they have a plan for his treatment. Are there other folks?
Carol Larson.
Carol Larson, they had an appointment in where's that place down there?
Lenore,
that place. And she's going to have some additional surgery on her foot before Dick's. Dick's surgery will be in early November.
I have a friend who traveled to Israel a couple weeks ago. In a hotel under lockdown. He says, oh, here's the trouble, but yeah. Doesn't feel too threatened by it, but he's stuck.
Oh, how awful. Julie and Bert Legrone were in Greenwood for his mother's funeral, mm-hmm. and they were exposed to COVID.
Oh, I didn't know that.
So they're not here today.
Oh, gosh.
Who was that?
I'm sorry, Julie and Bert Legrone. She teaches the elementary Sunday school class.
Bill's hanging in there.
We're on the countdown. We're into single digits.
We're down to single digits now.
He needs to talk to you, Jim, so I'm going to let you call him. He's having back surgery on the 17th, and it's weighing heavily on his mind.
Well, you know, I am well experienced in that regard.
Good.
As am I.
As am I.
Oh, mercy.
Well, let's pray. For the beauty of this morning, for just the gift of this morning, waking up, breathing the air that you provide, enjoying the beauty of this part of your world, and being able to be here. We give you thanks, and we ask that you bless our time together. We also ask that you hear our prayers for these who have been named our loved ones, who need you in special ways that you only know, and we ask that you be with them. Now, help us to grow as a result of hearing stories from your scriptures and hearing beautiful music as it interprets those stories. Bless us as we meet. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Come in.
Oh. You did that last week.
Came late, yes.
Yeah.
Hello there.
So last Sunday, my little part, I talked, I used a big word, recontextualization. The recontextualization of Scripture, and Mike, would you define that?
Sure.
The fact is that the Bible was written and compiled over hundreds of years in many different places, in many different historical settings. And sometimes folks from a later time took Scripture from an earlier time and applied it to their context. Some might accuse them of taking the earlier scriptures out of context, but what scholars tend to think is they were recontextualizing. They were taking a scripture and letting it speak in new and fresh ways in a different context. And that is precisely what many of the texts that Jennings chose to be the libretto of Messiah. He has taken an older text that had been reinterpreted in a later time, and then he has done that a third time by putting it into this libretto, into this, as Jim said rightly last week, into this drama of the salvation, God's salvation of humankind through Jesus Christ. And so these texts have been recontextualized two and three times. And so that's what that's what my part is. I'm going to try to help you understand the original context, and then we can see how they have been recontextualized.
So don't we still do that today?
Of course. Absolutely.
Look back at the 70s at some of the popular music that there is a season.
Absolutely. Right, you know. Absolutely.
We put it in rock and roll. We put it in, you know, all kinds of things.
Absolutely. Okay, so the first part of the Christmas section of Messiah, much of the scripture comes from the prophet Isaiah. And much of the very first part comes from the 40th chapter in the prophet Isaiah. And so let me just kind of set the historical scene for you of what was going on. So the time of King David and the time of King Solomon, David's son, was a very heady time for the Israelites. David, as you know, was the one king who just grabbed at God's heart. And even though David wasn't a perfect person, the kingdom of Israel under David and his son Solomon was at its pinnacle, was at its height. The territorial expansion, building, the Israel was becoming known around the wider world. The building of Solomon's temple was like a crowning jewel of this. People would look at that and just be in total amazement. But after Solomon's death, the kingdom split. They divided into a northern and a southern kingdom. The northern kingdom included 10 tribes. The northern kingdom had its capital in a different place from Jerusalem. And they selected a king not in the line of David. So the northern kingdom, the southern kingdom called Judah, northern kingdom was called Israel, southern kingdom called Judah, two tribes, Jerusalem, it had Jerusalem within its geographical boundaries, and it had kings in the line of David. In 721 BCE, the 8th century BCE, the northern kingdom was defeated by the geopolitical power of the day, Assyria. The southern kingdom was almost defeated, but not quite. So the northern kingdom was defeated, as was the strategy of the day. When you defeat a certain land, you take the brightest and the best of that land and you cart them off to your land. You import other people from other Assyrians into your conquered land. And we all know the Samaritans came from this defeat, intermixing of Assyrians with Jews, with Hebrews. And so Samaritans were always seen, always looked down on, in part because they were the continuing testimony to the defeat of the northern kingdom. So the northern kingdom was defeated. Southern kingdom continued to not thrive necessarily, but continued to exist until. And for the reason that the southern, the Judeans thought that they were spared was that they had Jerusalem, they had the temple, and they had the king in the line of David. It was called the Jerusalem theology. And they thought, no matter how bad they were, that God would never, ever, in God's wildest imaginations, allow Jerusalem to be defeated. Well, they were wrong. They were very wrong. And in 587 BCE, more than 100 years later, the new geopolitical threat in the world, the Persians, the Babylonians, defeated the southern kingdom of Judah, did the same thing, decimated Jerusalem, carried off the brightest and best into exile, imported some other people, and that is where the first words of Handel's Messiah will speak to. Let me just read to you a couple of passages that will these are familiar passages that, where is my, maybe I left it downstairs. I guess I did. When Jim does his thing, I'll go get them. For instance, Psalm 137 comes from this period of time. And I don't have it by memory, but you'll remember this. By the waters of Babylon, we sat down and wept. That's the psalmist talking about the sense of disillusionment and depression that the Israelites felt, having lost everything in Jerusalem and being carted off into Babylon. How can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? So there's this silence. God has gone silent. The people are in exile until this lone voice from Isaiah proclaims, comfort ye my people. The very first words in Handel's Messiah. Any questions about that?
I want to just interject. There's another fantastic oratorio by William Walton entitled Belshazzar, which deals exactly with what Pitt's talking about. And one of the major pieces in that is that song, by the waters of Babylon, there we sat down and wept, yea, we wept. And that deals with the defeat of Belshazzar.
So I'm going to go on and do the second part, the scriptures in the second part, and then just turn it all over to Jim. So you might ask, what was the reason behind Isaiah's ability to comfort the people? Nothing seemed to them to have changed. But on the geopolitical stage, something had changed. Assyria was no longer the power in the world. Persia was. I mean, Babylon was no longer the power in the world. Persia was. And the king of Persia, a man named Cyrus, conquered the Babylonians, and he took a different tact in terms of having his conquered people. He did not try to separate the folks from their land. He did not try to decimate. He, in fact, allowed the Israelites, the Judeans, to return to Jerusalem and to rebuild their temple, their city. And so that came as good news. Even there is scripture in which Cyrus is spoken of as God's anointed, which is a word that was only reserved for kings in the Davidic line. But you see how people are interpreting geopolitical movements as God's working God's purpose out for God's people. And so Cyrus began to be seen, someone who did not worship this same God, but was in theological terms, biblical terms, was God's anointed. And so the
how many years between Babylon's and Persians coming and taking over?
48 years. So a couple of generations. So there still would have been, and this will be important, there still would have been people who returned to Jerusalem who remembered the former glory. And that sort of sets us up to the next stage of Messiah. So these years later, folks start dribbling back. I did forget, there's a portion of Messiah which talks about the trip back home. And the valleys will be lifted up and the mountains will be made low. And because you had these people who remembered what a struggle it was to be taken into Babylon, and then they had to think about going back. It's that same desert, it's those same challenges. And there are a couple of different interpretations of that. Either the prophet is talking about the valleys will be made high and the mountains low so that the people can have an easier way back. But probably more accurate is that this is talking about God going back. That God is making this way, you know, the rough places smooth. God is, so that God's re-enthronement in Jerusalem can take place. So we'll hear that. So when the people got back, things were better, but not great. The economy stunk. They were struggling. Their families were struggling. Jerusalem didn't look anything like it had before the Babylonians destroyed it. And so they began to ask why. Enter the prophet Haggai. And Haggai says, the reason why things aren't better than they are, things aren't as good as the prophet Isaiah predicted they would be, is because you guys have been taking care of yourselves and not God. You guys have been building your own houses, but you haven't yet built a house for God. And if you build the temple as God has commanded you to do, things will get better fast. So that's Haggai's word. They built the temple, they responded, they changed. And yet, years went by and things still weren't great. And these folks who were older, but they were, those folks who went into exile back to Israel and still could remember the glory of the temple, they realized that things were not, I mean, this was just a vestige of what had been. Enter another prophet, Prophet Malachi. And Malachi says, okay, you built the temple for God. You built God's house. It's not what it used to be, but it's still a house for God. The problem is people like me. The problem is the priests. Because those priests aren't being faithful to God's word. they are only doing for them, they're taking the best sacrifices for themselves, they're cheating, they're lying, they're abusing, the priests are just a moral wasteland. And so that, when that comes in with the, I wish I had my scripture passages, but the whole prophecy about the purification, and will heal, and he shall purify, right? That's what he's talking about, this Malachi's prophecy, that what needs to happen is that the leadership, the religious leadership needs to be purified. And it's like the prophets were always drawing this contrast between the mere performance of religiosity and what God really wanted. And these prophets, they were not, I mean, these priests were not doing what God really wanted. All right.
And God was a God of wrath. And that's how he got purified.
That's how he got
God's wrath. Anybody not here last week? I know Donald wasn't. Okay. Could you distribute those? Then I have another handout. Education 101. If they come away with nothing from your lesson, they'll at least have a piece of paper.
Because she forgot hers, too.
Oh.
Mine's in the car.
Uh-huh. That's all right. We'll survive.
I'll throw my desk.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yes, this is a new one.
Well, that's been done. I want to talk just briefly. So we'll start off with just a little bit of a summary of last week. I think that's helpful. We talked about the difference between Bach and Handel. They're really focused on Handel and his coming to England and turning from writing opera to oratorios. And we know that Messiah was first performed in 1741 in Dublin. And although it has a sacred text, it's very important to understand that the music is secular in style. It's not really sacred music. It's the same kind of music he was writing when he was writing opera. Now, that doesn't diminish the quality of the composition. It's just that basically at that time there was a universal style of music. All in all, there are 56 performances of Messiah during Handel's lifetime in England.
56.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. So it became very popular very rapidly. And one of the main places was the Foundling Hospital, and it was used as a charity concerts for orphans and other people that needed help. We talked about the structure, overall structure of Messiah, in three main sections. The part one deals, of course, with the prophecy. Part two is the passion and the ascension of Christ. And third is the thanksgiving for the defeat of death. So Christmas comes into part one, Lent and Easter part two. And in part three, it's important that God changes from God of wrath to God of grace and love. Overall, as far as the various movements of Messiah, it's structured on the form of the Italian cantata, which means to as opposed to sonata means a play, cantata means to sing. That structure was a recitative, which is sung by a solo singer with accompaniment of various types. It can be an ongoing accompaniment underlining the text, or it can be what we call secco or dry recitative, where the accompaniment just punctuates. And you'll hear this in the first recitative. Then it'd be followed by an era or an aria, which is expounding upon the text of the recitative. In opera, the recitative tended to be very long. That was the story that was being told. An aria, it would be an amplification. It's like a soliloquy in a Shakespeare, to be or not to be. And then you have the chorus, which follows the aria, which is a summation or a glorification of it all. Think of the Greek drama, for instance. You really don't have that much choral work in opera like you do in the oratorios, but it's more like the Greek chorus that we had in ancient Greek plays. It was the choral writing that elevated Handel's oratorios to the status which we hold them, and the reverence which we hold them today. It's magnificent, magnificent writing, and very powerful. And this is what, I mean, if there's one piece from Messiah that everybody knows, it's what? The Hallelujah Chorus, plain and simple. And it's this glorious choral writing that really sets his oratorios apart.
Jim, how long is the whole thing, if it was back, back, back? What is the length of time?
It would run about without intermission. Mm-hmm. Okay, because we always have an intermission. It would run about 2 hours.
2 hours.
Yeah.
Did he write it intentionally for that length of time, or did he write it for segments that could be done individually?
First of all, we have to understand there is not a definitive version of Messiah. It changed constantly based on the performance situation. Where it was being performed, the performers available. So what we have really now is sort of a cut and paste. We generally, it goes from the founding hospital performance, which seems to be closest to Handel's intentions, because he was in charge of it. But it would take anywhere, I could say, it'd take about a 2 hour performance, which is pretty well covered. He was well aware of the time frame and what it should fit into, which is also what a typical opera, it's only 2.5 hours with intermission. And that's essentially what we had here. Never forget the influence of the opera on what he was writing. Therefore, the music is dramatic. So let's listen to the first three numbers uninterrupted. The first one is a recitative. Comfort ye, my people. It starts off accompanied, and then when it gets to the next section, the voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, it becomes dry or secco recitative punctuation. Then in the following aria or air, every valley shall be exalted, the mountains and hills made low. We have glorious word painting. That was an important part of Baroque music. It was called the doctrine of affections. That's not affection like I love you, but affectation is the word that we're looking for. They had, should we say, standard ways of expressing things. If they're talking about height, the music goes up. If they're talking about lowness, the music goes down. If they're talking about exalting, it tends to be very flowery and florid. And if it's talking about grief, it becomes a whole different character. There are even things which you would never know. Symbols, like for the cross, the music goes doom, 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 doom. And you connect the dots, and you have a cross. Bach was very famous for his use of the cross motif. So, here we go.
And that's not complete.
Now, I'll talk a little bit. We have a long text in short music. You hear the accompaniment. Transition to this dry or secco recitative to finish out the text. It's repressed. Exalted fun. Notice the dramatic flair. Word painting. Summarizing what we've just heard. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed. See how the single voices come out being revealed. Several things to notice. And all flesh, just all of a sudden then they come together, shall see it together. Again, dramatic writing. Handel did not have, as he had the opera, scenery and staging. So he has to really, this is where the drama really comes, is in the chorus writing. It's glorious. The way he differentiates people, the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. That's a whole different feeling than all flesh shall see it, the people. Really differentiates the two beautifully, beautifully. So that is the first quote-unquote scene that we have in part one. So we go now to the second scene, which is the wrath of God. It starts with a bass recitative, which again starts accompanied and progresses to dry or secco. Again, we have some word painting in here. And I will shake, shaking, 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 followed by an air. Now, when I was first singing Messiah, this was always continued by the bass. The bass sings the recitative, and then sings Bethumay above. Never in Handel's lifetime did that happen. This was written for an alto, actually a male alto, guadagno. And for some reason, it became fashionable and habitual to have the bass continue with the aria. But as I say, never in Handel's time did that happen. So now it's traditionally sung by an alto as it was at that time. Continuing the pattern, recitative aria chorus, a recitative air chorus, we have a concluding, he shall purify. Once again, the idea here is that we are purified by God's wrath. In the Old Testament, that is, not today. So we have, thus saith the Lord of hosts, what's in a little while, and I will shake into the heavens and the earth, the field and dry land. Then who may abide the day of his coming? It's an extended aria with the middle portion where you actually hear the fire in the violins, in the strings. For he is like the refiner's fire. You'll hear that. And then he shall purify the concluding chorus. Now, this is very interesting part of Baroque music in general. The music for this chorus was originally, it was derived from a two-part Italian duet, which had a secular text. The translation is, the flower that laughs in the dawn withers in the sunlight. Life, too, is a flower. It comes in the morning and dies in the spring of a single day. From that, Handel constructed a complete chorus of He Shall Purify. Now, the music is no less secular than it was in the Italian duet. This happened extremely common. It was extremely common in the Baroque to borrow and paste. Bach did it. Handel did it probably more than most composers. But back then, it was not frowned upon as it is today, as far as plagiarism. It was just standard practice. That's one reason Handel, it's not the only thing that Handel borrowed, and we'll, if we went through the whole piece, I'd point out numerous instances of where this happened. But it's just a very interesting compositional process with Baroque music. So let's listen to
the wrath.
This, the wrath of God. Yes.
My man,
now back to the secco.
And suddenly come to his temple. Even the messenger of the covenant. He delighted. Behold, he shall come. Said the Lord of hosts.
This is so comforting. Same thing repeated. So in the interest of time, I'm going to move ahead to that. But the dramatic writing is just phenomenal. Mm-hmm. It just, I mean, the creative, how many days did it take him? Who can remember? 24 days to put all this together. It's phenomenal. Phenomenal. Now, can we move ahead to the concluding chorus of this portion, which comes from, again, that Italian cantata. I know, of course, people have to go, choir people have to go. Can you move to the next one? Notice the purity of that. We hope. All these little statements will be brought together.
Thank you.
So that concludes the first part of part one. Any questions?
Jim, I'm curious. You said 24 days to develop the whole thing. Is that right?
Yes.
The orchestration and the vocalists, were they ever brought in? Or was it all in his head?
Yes.
I guess is what I'm saying.
Well, basically, yes.
So he didn't bring in an orchestra, he didn't bring in the vocalists to actually perform some of it as he wrote it.
As a trial. No.
Wow.
No. But he had a keyboard.
He had a keyboard.
Yeah. He was a fabulous organist, as was Bach. And he always had a harpsichord right there in front of him as he was composing. So he would play it. But still a lot of it was already up here. And also remember, some of it was borrowed, like that chorus.
Sure.
Pre-composed.
To develop it all in his head is just incredible. That's
that's what it's all about. Keep in mind, Beethoven wrote some of his greatest works when he was deaf. He could only imagine in his inner ear what that music would sound like. Mozart rarely composed at the piano. Everything was already up here. And he'd just sit down and choo, choo, choo. It's, you know, these people as musicians stiff on a whole different plane than us mere mortals, I would say.
So after 24 days, he actually brought together an orchestra and he brought together these vocalists and just performed it? Or?
No. There was a span of time he was searching for a place to perform it. Uh-huh. And I think about 2 or 3 months went by between when he finished composing and when it was first performed in Dublin at Easter. I think it finished around Christmas time in 1741, or 1740, and then in 1741 it was performed in Dublin at Easter time. So there was time in between.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure the quality of the performances back then, because they were thrown together very quickly. Bach would write a cantata during the week for the Sunday service.
So the first time I saw the music would be Sunday when somebody...
No, probably he had a short rehearsal on Thursday for the Sunday service.
6:30
in the choir.
Yeah. Limited to an hour. Everybody's got to go.
And then they would perform it.
So did he change it after he maybe heard that first performance? Did he make any changes? Do we know?
He made some, but not a lot. The librettist, Jennings, was imploring him to make changes because he didn't feel the music was worthy of his libretto. And he said, to heck with you. He did not make too many changes.
I thought this chorus
is, we got usher.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. That was great.
You're welcome. So next week we'll talk about the third or the second scene.
Jim, the way he issued the not so veiled threat to the priests being the sons of Levi.
Right. Exactly.
He
will purify the sons of Levi.
Yes.
Because they were the
priests.
That's
the tribe. Oh yes.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Patty's. They're warm.